Good afternoon, everyone. I think we're going to get ready to get started now. I'm Eileen Theodore Schuster. I'm the chair of the diversity committee. And I just had a few details. I don't know if you've been here in Austin before, but just so you know, bathroom facilities are across the elevator lobby and to your left. And the emergency exit is in this lobby here, so you turn right leaving this room, and it will be just before you go into the faculty commons. Hopefully we don't need to know where the emergency exit is, but it's always good to say something. And I want to invite Tim Smith up. He is our subject librarian for classic world religion.
Right.
He can introduce himself better. Come on up, Tim.
I am the subject librarian for Classics and World Religions, and just want to say a few words about Dr. Lybarger. Known him, first met him, 7 years ago when he started here. Joined the Department of Classics and World Religions. Didn't know until a few minutes ago I asked him what I thought was a simple question for an introduction. Where are you from? And he said, not such a simple answer for him. He said, born in Pakistan, but Cleveland, maybe some other places too. So he's kind of from a variety of places. Anyway, he's been teaching Islam and Sufism and world religions in general here for the last 77 years now. Particularly interested in things related to the Palestinians and religion and nationalism, Islam and nationalism, the Islamist movement and so forth. He's published a number of articles and book reviews over the years, and in 2007, Princeton University Press published his book, Identity and Religion in Palestine, The Struggle Between Islamism and Secularism in the Occupied Territories. And I just, from reading a review of that, I found out that he lived and worked among Palestinian villagers in refugee camps and have as part of research for that book. And more recently, he was awarded a fellowship from the National Endowment for the Humanities to do research on Palestinian refugees in Chicago. In fact, he'll be in Chicago then next year doing fieldwork for that study. And lastly, it's gone to the slide now, the topic for his presentation today is Hearing the Qur'an, Sound and Meaning in Islam's Holy Book. I'll give you Dr. Loren Lybarger. Thank you.
Hearing right now is a recitation from Surat Maryam, the chapter of Mary, in which the story of Mary and Jesus is one of the places in the Qur'an where the story of Mary and Jesus is recounted. And I'll have more to say about Maryam as I encountered her early on in my time living in the occupied Palestinian territories, particularly in a town just adjacent to Bethlehem. But I wanted to play this for you to give some sense of the kind of ambiance that is created when the Qur'an intervenes into the soundscapes of our daily lives. And I'll talk about this notion of soundscape as well. So the title of my talk is Hearing the Qur'an, literally hearing it, listening to it. The way in which Muslims encounter the Qur'an, one of the primary ways in which Muslims encounter the Qur'an is precisely in its recited form. The Qur'an literally means that which is recited. I'm so used to walking over to my... So, to sort of get things going here, I thought that I would pose a very basic question. What is the Qur'an? I've already sort of given you one possible definition, sort of the literal one, right? That which is recited. Another way to think about the Qur'an, if you were to ask a Muslim, perhaps you might get this answer, right? The Qur'an is Islam's holy book of revelation purporting to be the very words of God addressed to humanity. Not necessarily purporting, but for a Muslim, the answer would be the Qur'an is the very word of God addressed to humanity through the Prophet Muhammad as conveyed through the angel Gabriel. So by tradition, the story is that the angel Gabriel brings the Qur'an to the Prophet Muhammad and commands him to do what? Iqra, to recite. Okay, from Iqra, we get Iqra is the same root, from that same root in Arabic, we get the word Qur'an. So Qur'an, Iqra, recite that which is recited. The Qur'an then comes into being primarily from the very beginning as a recited phenomenon or text. Muslims have a variety of names for the Qur'an, and these names derive from the way the Qur'an itself refers to itself. Al-Kitab, the book, for example. So the Qur'an is thought of as a book, as a physical object of the book, and here is an example of one, a Mus'haf, a copy of the Qur'an. This one has particular meaning for me, given to me by a very good friend after she got back from pilgrimage, Hajj, in Saudi Arabia. Mus'haf, a copy. Huda, the guidance. So the Qur'an is not just any book, but a book that provides guidance for life, for how to live. A tanzil, that which is sent down. Al-Furqan, one of my favorites in terms of names for the Qur'an. Al-Furqan, the criterion of truth and error. So the coming down of the Qur'an imposes a criterion and confronts the listener, confronts the human being with a kind of decision. Will you be on the side of truth or will you be on the side of those who have gone astray? So it is a text that demands a response. The Qur'an is a book, it's not a typical book in the way that we think of, say, a Harry Potter book, right? We wouldn't necessarily think of Harry Potter books in the way that we might think of the Qur'an, at least in terms of how Muslims engage the Quranic text. But it is a book, right? I mean, it has a cover, yeah, and pages, and these days you can search this book electronically, so it exists in virtual form as well. It is studied, commented on, debated, has been for centuries, almost from the very beginning. Contains narratives, odes, exhortations, polemical, variety of rhetorical forms, similar to what you might encounter in other written texts, and it seeks to communicate and to teach. Again, in the way that books do. Books are mediums through which authors attempt to communicate with an audience, right? And as an audience, you enter readership, you enter into communication, conversation with the author. Sometimes you might take it upon yourself to write to the author directly. I've received an email from somebody, I have no idea who this person is, responding to my book on Palestinians. She addressed it to me as Loren and signed it with her first name, and I have no idea who she is. And don't plan to respond to her. She was very critical of me. So, delete. Oh, the joys of emailing. Yet the Qur'an is also not like any other book we might think of at all, but rather something that is not only read, but also heard. I've already indicated how the Qur'an, in a sense, is an oral text right from the start. On the screen here, let's see if this works. Okay. Mount Hira, seen here in the top photograph, is where the Prophet Muhammad was said to have received his revelations. Now, he had been in the habit, this would have been, you know, around about 610 of the Common Era. He was often in the habit of going up onto this mountain. He was a very sort of meditative, mystical kind of person, if you will, somebody who was seeking the divine, as various hermits and monks did in the Near East for centuries before him and after him. And during one of these moments on Mount Hira, he has this incredible experience. And you see here a close-up of the cave on Mount Hira where he is believed to have received his revelation. So Muhammad was on Mount Hira in the year 610. He was about 40 years old, just ripe for a midlife crisis. And he was called to recite. The angel appears, the angel Gabriel appears to him, and according to tradition, to Islamic tradition, Muhammad was commanded to say these words by the angel. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق. Recite in the name of your Lord, who created the human being from a drop of fluid, of perhaps semen. And these were said to be the very first word. And what's kind of revealing for me, what is revealing for me, is that this moment of prophecy, this inbreaking of the divine into the human realm, is very much in the meaning of the text associated with the act of creation. Recite in the name of your Lord who created. Okay? And I'll come back to this linkage between prophecy and creation in a few minutes. Muhammad was terrified at this prospect. He didn't quite take to this immediately. And so, as tradition has it, he later describes, right, according to tradition, of this sensation of being squeezed almost to the point of collapse. The angel, in a sense, is this very powerful presence, suffocating presence almost. And he's commanded to speak and to recite, or to read, if you will. And he says, I can't. I don't know how. I cannot. And the angel is persistent. You shall recite, 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 recite in the name of your Lord who created. Muhammad flees the mountain and seeks comfort in the arms of his wife Khadija, who then has him meet with her cousin, a Christian, who says, yo, Muhammad, this is for real. You're not going nuts, you're not going crazy, but this is from God. And in other words, just sort of chill and let this thing happen. And for the next 22 years, this thing happened. And he received revelations for the next 22 years until his death. The Qur'an, then, is, as I said, that which is read or that which is recited. Muhammad is called to recite. The Qur'an, I would argue, exists, then, if one could say the Qur'an exists in multiple forms, at least three. According to Muslim Islamic tradition, the Qur'an is said to exist in a heavenly form. And what is brought down and made manifest in and fixed within human language is, in a sense, a copy of this heavenly divine speech. And this led to a huge debate among Muslims about whether the actual physical Qur'an was created or uncreated. I'm not going to go into this, but it was a version of the debate that Christians had about Jesus. Is he divine? Is he human? Is he both? What gives? And Muslims have a similar debate about the Qur'an. Is it divine? Is it not? Is it both? What is it exactly? Ultimately, Muslims decide that indeed the text is divine. It is the divine word of God. And there are a whole host of issues that are associated with this. I don't have time to get into it, but I wanted to just let you in on this debate. It's a debate that was very important in the history of Islam. And as I said, it's a question that arises, I think, whenever a religious tradition is grappling with a notion of a divine other that nevertheless relates to, breaks into the realm of the human. How, in what sense, is the human capable of the divine capable of the human? It is fundamentally contradictory. How is that relationship understood, imagined? And in the hearing and reciting the Quran, that problem is worked out by Muslims in certain ways that I'm going to start to get into a little bit more here. The Qur'an is also, of course, in a written form. So from the very beginning, the Qur'an was written down by people who were listening to the Prophet, part of his growing entourage of early followers. They wrote this Qur'an down, these recitations down on whatever materials might have been available at hand, palm leaves, papyri, other materials. It also existed almost from the very beginning as well in an oral, well, obviously from the very beginning, in oral form. And to this day, the Qur'an is preserved in oral form. People memorize the Qur'an, the entirety of it. And to become a hafiz, to become one who is remembered and, in a sense, holds the Qur'an, right? It guards the Qur'an. in memory is to achieve something quite great, and one is honored quite a bit by Muslims, among Muslims, once one has achieved this. Is there anybody in this room who is Hafiz al-Qur'an? So we have somebody in the room who has actually memorized the Qur'an. If I should ever render something in this talk from the Qur'an incorrectly, please by all means stop me and correct me, because I know that that is actually quite important, that the Qur'anic speech be rendered correctly is of great importance, right? Of course it would be, if it is the divine word of God, according to Muslims. One other point about the oral Qur'an, for traditionally, the oral is said to correct the written. In fact, the oral Qur'an is held to be traditionally of greater authority, interestingly enough. So I want to talk about the Qur'an. I mentioned this whole notion of soundscape, right? And I've been playing this soundtrack of the recitation from Surah Maryam in the background, in a sense, in an attempt of my own to try to create a kind of Qur'anic atmosphere. As you're listening to this, I'm tempted to turn off the lights and end the lecture here, just have you, you know, listen to the text and let it speak for itself. No, seriously, I mean, I won't do that, but the Qur'an, in a sense, how do you come to the Qur'an and understand it? Well, in a way, there is really no other way but to sort of immerse yourself in it and allow yourself to be taken up into it. The Qur'an, as recited speech, very much creates what I will call a soundscape. A soundscape is something, if you think of a landscape, right? A landscape that is intentionally formed and created by human beings. You know, you think of a built environment, right? And architects are very, very tuned to the importance of a built environment and how it can shape our thought patterns, the way we orient ourselves, and the way that we feel, the kinds of emotions that we experience, can be very powerfully affected by the built environment or the landscape around us. A soundscape does something very similar. It can orient you, cause you to have thought connections and to experience emotions in certain ways. And the Qur'an is very much concerned, interested in shaping a soundscape that becomes very important in the conveyance of the message that it seeks to convey to human beings. So how many of you understand what's being said right now? So we have two and one shwaya shwaya. The rest of you don't know what's being heard, but in a sense, as you listen to it, most Muslims will probably tell you that they do not understand what is being recited when they hear the Quran. The vast majority of Muslims do not understand Arabic at all. But they might memorize certain passages from the Qur'an as they grow up and go through school, probably do, especially if they come from pious families. And they hear it all the time in their day-to-day lives. If you live in a Muslim-majority society, the Qur'an is a part of the daily sound that you encounter as you go through your day. But you may not understand a word of it. In a sense, I'm not going to say it doesn't matter, but to not know what you're hearing doesn't necessarily mean that you don't understand what is being said, that there is something being communicated nonetheless through the recitation. Quranic recitation is ubiquitous. It interweaves sonically with profane sound, car horns, conversation, pop music. I'm going to take a break here for a second, pause this, and then I'm going to bring this back up. So I found this on YouTube. I thought it was quite interesting. And it sort of gives you some sense of the way in which the Qur'an can sort of intervene in daily life. Beirut. He's reciting Qur'an. You can hear the bustle of the cars in the background. Sometimes passers-by will come by and offer some sadaqah, some alms. So the Qur'an can intervene in the sounds of daily life through the agency of an individual who might just simply sit down and decide to recite. And you see passersby sort of being caught, oh, wait a minute, the Qur'an. And I think somebody gives sadaqah. Or some, maybe somebody will stop and listen. I think of, I lived in Chicago, consider Chicago my second home. How many times have I been on the L, in the L station, and heard a musician or a rapper, and people gathering around, right? And you know, the music of this performer intervening and stopping my day, right, causing me to sort of enter into a different kind of space and time, making me sort of reflect and think, perhaps, about something that's going through in the music, even if I don't understand exactly what a rapper is saying. The sounds of the Qur'an can intervene in our lives, in the lives of people, in their daily lives. At times, the Qur'an can become the dominant sound in early morning recitations before sort of before Fajr prayer, or the dawn prayer. During Ramadan, in the evenings, you will hear recitations of the Qur'an. The Qur'an, in a sense, begins to take over the public space. Formal Qur'an recitation and recitation competitions are a big deal. They occur throughout societies in which Muslims form a dominant presence. Indonesia, for instance, does a lot of this. I happen to be familiar with that. A lot of Qur'an recitation competitions. Really important premium place, and really good reciters are rock stars. I mean, you go to their YouTube sites and you can see, you know, the ones that, like Al-Fasi, for instance, is a reciter that gets a lot of viewings on YouTube, and deservedly so, beautiful voice. So it matters, the rendering of the Qur'an and how it is rendered vocally, it matters. The aesthetics of the Qur'anic recitation really matter. It needs to be rendered beautifully. Okay, the recitation of the Qur'an creates a collective meditative mood. It's kind of what I was hoping, aiming for in the playing of the recitation of Surah Maryam, initially at the beginning of the lecture. I remember experience of taking a taxi. I lived in the Gaza Strip for many years, or for a couple of years, and taking taxis between Gaza. This was before the big wall and the checkpoints and all the other stuff happened, where it was still relatively easy to travel between Gaza and Jerusalem and get into a Gaza taxi. But there was always a whole lot of tension, especially as we approached the military checkpoint. And oftentimes the driver would put a tape, this was, you know, back in the days of analog, would put a cassette tape into the tape player of recitation, or turn on the radio with recitation on it, and the mood in the taxi, the tension would begin to dissipate. So the Quranic recitation can have this kind of calming effect. Part of the meaning, right, of what can be communicated even when you don't understand the words. The Quran then functions sonically to draw listeners into an alternate time space with a kind of parallel narrative and memory, a kind of mythic memory, reminding listeners of a different kind of time scale, drawing them into a kind of biblical Quranic soundscape. Let's see here. Oh, I wanted to play this for you. This was interesting. Well, no, I'll skip that. I think you kind of get the point here. So the Quran intervenes in our profane time, and Muslims talk about the beauty of the Quranic recitation in terms of the level of Qur'an, the ijaz of Qur'an, the miracle of the Qur'an, and that the very speech of the Qur'an, the sound of the Qur'an, can have a kind of effect or impact on people. I mentioned, you know, being in the Gaza taxi and sort of the calming effect that had. And the ways in which it draws listeners into sort of a parallel reality, one different from the hardships of their daily lives. But what if you're not Muslim? What if you're living in a community in which Muslims live alongside non-Muslims? And there's a clip here from YouTube that I was going to play of, I don't have time, but I might come back to it. Where you have these Muslims standing on a street corner, mixed of in London, right, from British Muslims and with some immigrant Muslims, And there's this one guy, beautiful voice, right? And he's reciting the Qur'an. But the text that he's reciting is all about how the unbelievers will perish in the fires of hell. And it's sort of ironic because there's such beauty of the recitation, and yet this recitation is being directed at people who are walking by, not even paying attention to him. But there's a sense in which, right, I mean, okay, so one has to wonder, what's he trying to do here? The listeners don't understand Arabic, they're not really paying attention to him. But there's a sense in which, you know, his rendering of the speech of the Qur'an as a kind of witness to the world, calling on non-believers to hear and obey, even if they don't understand what is being said, that the very recitation of the text itself will be efficacious, in the sense that this is divine speech, and the very rendering of that speech will have an effect, an impact, if recited, even if people don't understand the words themselves. But coming back to this question, what if you're not a Muslim? What if you live in a place like Bethlehem, which is predominantly a Christian town, with a very significant proportion of Muslims as well? I want to tell you a little story about how I first encountered the Qur'an in a really serious and in-depth way. And this occurred when I was living in the West Bank, in the town of Beit Jala, which is about 70% Christian, just outside of Bethlehem, which is about today 60% Christian, historically Christian towns in Palestine, with important Muslim population as well. And I was, I played classical guitar, and I was invited to come and play guitar for a Christmas Eve service at the Lutheran Church, the Arabic Palestinian Lutheran Church at Bethlehem. So I agreed, and I brought my guitar along, and I played at the church that evening. Afterward, I decided, well, I'm going to spend some time walking through Bethlehem. And Christmas Eve is a big deal in Bethlehem. At the time, I wasn't even aware of how obvious a statement that would have been. Yes, it's a big deal. It's a big city, and it's a big deal, and it's a huge tourist bonanza, a tourist business bonanza, where the Israelis and the Palestinian business people sort of, you know, have found ways at different times to collaborate with one another. So the Israelis would come in with a heavy military presence, set of checkpoints and all of this, and then all these tourists would be bussed on these big, huge buses from Jerusalem, from the hotel to Jerusalem, into Bethlehem for the Christmas Eve festivities. And it was just, you know, a real sort of party atmosphere. And, you know, there, you would have these American and European tourists, you know, walking around with gin bottles and vodka bottles, getting drunk off their ass, intermingling with, you know, pilgrims, religious pilgrims who were coming to the Church of the Nativity, the Basilica of the Nativity Church. And in the midst of all of that, I'm walking around with my guitar, and I hear, Loren, ya Loren! And I turn, and there's my friend Yusuf, who I just met maybe 2 months ago. He was student teaching in the school in which I was teaching. And Yusuf calls me over, and he had been sitting in front of a store shop, of a shop that was owned by a friend of his. And he had a small charcoal fire going, and he was making coffee. And he invited me to sit down. He said, you know, come sit down, have a cup of coffee with me. It was about 9-10 o'clock at night, and I sat down, and for the next 5 hours until about 3 o'clock in the morning, we talked. And we talked about Maryam, the mother of Jesus, and about Jesus. Primarily Yusuf telling me the story. A story that I knew really, really well, or at least I thought I did. One of the things that I learned from Yusuf was that, well, Maryam found herself underneath a palm tree, a date tree. And the pangs of childbirth called out, oh, that I had been, forsaken and spared this pain. It's not exactly, but that's kind of what she says. And a voice calls out to her and says, calm down. A rivulet of water appeared beneath her, and dates began to fall down upon her. That's not part of the story. What are you kidding me? It's not in the New Testament. Not my book. full disclosure, at that time I was a fairly practicing Christian. Long story. I'm not a Muslim, and I've gone on quite a journey. But at the time, I was a very devout Christian. So I knew my Bible, a Protestant Christian, right? Most Protestants know our Bibles. So I knew the Bible, and I said, that's not enough story. Later, I realized that, in a sense, that little detail is part of our story. Right? It's not in the canonical New Testament, but it is in books, Christian literature, that never made it into the Bible. And the Qur'an had picked up on these details, right? And I'm not making any suggestions here necessarily about how that happened or what the process was. Only to say that these details that are told in the Qur'an are details that exist in other literatures that Christians have forgotten about. Anyway, Yusuf and I got into this long discussion about Mary. And as I began to think about this, I thought, you know, so what's going on here? And I ended up writing an article on the figure of Mary for an academic journal, so I've given a lot of thought to this. And I began to think about the Qur'an as a kind of literature that calls. We can think of Qur'anic callings. So for instance, throughout the Qur'an, you see these kinds of exclamations or appeals to the people of the book. Ya ahl al-kitab. Here's a good example of it here. يا أهل الكتاب لا تغلوا في دينكم ولا تقولوا على الله إلى الحق إنما المسيح عيسى ابن مريم رسول الله وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم والروح منه and so on. So, O people of the scripture, يا أهل الكتاب, O people of the scripture, O Christians and Jews, do not commit excess in your religion or say about Allah, except the truth, the Messiah, Jesus the Son of Mary, was but a messenger of Allah and his word, which he directed to Mary and a soul created at a command. So Jesus being a soul from God. So believe in Allah and his messenger and do not say three. Don't talk about the Trinity. It is better for you if you did not do this. Indeed, Allah is but one God. Exalted is he above having a son. The Qur'an is intervening in a debate here, is engaging Christians and Muslims and saying, yo, you got it wrong! Wake up! Here's the real deal! Here's what really happened! And you Christians and Jews, you're fighting about this and you're not even fighting about the right version of the story, right? So here's the Qur'an entering into this debate. And what I find really interesting and significant about this is how, in a sense, the implicit understanding here is that the Qur'an is a part of this biblical, if you will, tradition. The Qur'an is a biblical text in this sense, in that it tells the same stories, and it enters into this discussion. And the term that I want to use for this is, midrashic. In the sense of the Jewish rabbinic idea of telling stories about stories as a way to explain stories. The Quran is a midrashic text. It intervenes in the Jewish-Christian conversation about Jesus, for example, by offering its own version of the Jesus story, by telling the Jesus story in a different way. It's also a didactic text that tells the Jesus story as a way to teach us something, to teach us about prophets, about how to live properly. Jesus is a model, right? But he's a Quranic model, a model that models for us an understanding of what a prophet is. And lo and behold, Jesus as a Quranic prophet looks a lot like Muhammad as a prophet, okay? So a kind of Quranic prophet model is developed through the storytelling of Jesus. The point that I want to make here, though, is that in debating Jesus with Yusuf, I was hearing the Quranic call. It was, in a sense, another way in which the Quran enters into, shapes the sort of soundscape that we are a part of, in this case, discursively, right? A discourse that is uttered, and in conversation, the midrashic practice of the Quran is extended. Yusuf and I were engaged in a kind of midrashic conversation, carrying on our own interpretive work that was Quranically shaped, biblically shaped as well. The text then is midrashic, but it also spurs debate that itself enacts and extends the midrashic impulse. In Bethlehem, in that moment that I was describing to you, such a moment was occasioned dialectically by a Christian remembrance of Jesus' birth going on around us. Jesus then exists in an intertextual echo chamber. The implications of the story, whether in recitations or conversations, sound in multiple registers across Muslim and Christian texts, and Jewish texts for that matter, too. To recite Jesus' story, then, is to invoke the appeal to the Ahl al-Kitab, to the people of the book. The Quran is calling to the people of the book, demanding an answer and engaging them. It shapes, through that storytelling, conversations that occur among people. All of this got me thinking for today's presentation about sound and memory. How does sound, memory, and meaning interact with one another? Obviously, I've talked about it in two ways: recitations that create an ambiance, and conversation, the way in which the Quran intervenes in the spoken word between people. These evocations, these callings, and the consequent meanings that they bring into consciousness occur not only linguistically, but sonically. So how does sound relate to meaning? And here I want to introduce this notion of the sound figure. So I thought this was pretty good. Hey, do you know what the French word for scad is? No. Gal. That doesn't sound that bad to me. No! It makes me puke and barf! So when we hear words, we often associate those words with feelings and remembered experiences. Think of the word pus. Pus. What comes to mind for you?
Gross
cyst oozing. I mean, but come on, the word pus. It's just pus. It's just a sound, right? Pus. 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 Am I creeping you out here? Right? We think if you've grown up in an English-speaking linguistic cultural setting, American linguistic cultural setting, you're going to associate that word with something that we have culturally and socially agreed upon is yucky, revolting. Yeah, losing, ugh, impure. Stay away from it. If you really want to gross your sister out, then you go, suck my pus. Gross you out. Pus, right? So we hear the word, we associate with an image, a sound figure. Sound figures, though, aren't so simple, straightforward. They can be quite complex. So let's consider this. Abstract concept to concrete figures, thus rendering abstraction understandable. Good example of this: time is money. Abstract concept of time figured concretely as money. We talk about this all the time: living on borrowed time, a waste of time. Wonderfully capitalistic, right? Argument is war. She demolished my argument. You disagree? Okay, shoot! Metaphors also link concepts to experiences and associated emotions. Conjures a feeling or memory that endows the abstract meaning with an emotional force, living on borrowed time might trigger anxiety, right? We connect that with death, maybe, or with the end of the world. Planet Earth is living on borrowed time with all this carbon being sent up into our atmosphere. So, Start Me Up links two texts together, the song's lyrics and the Microsoft commercial. Third text, the listener, is involved in this as well, bringing his or her subjective encounter with these things. So Start Me Up, for me, conjures a personal memory linked to ecstatic, unfiltered self-abandonment during my adolescence. Riding around with Tommy Perbola in his Chevy Nova with a six-pack of beer between us.
Oh.
Don't tell my mom. It's crazy when I'm an adolescent. And then Microsoft, right? How does it work? So let's return to matters sacred for a moment. How do Quranic sound figures work? They sonically link together similar phrases that occur in different narrative contexts. When a listener hears such a phrasing, she or he may discern an echo or similar phrasing occurs elsewhere in the Quran. She or he also connects the sound figure with personal experiences and the feelings associated with it. So an example that I want to get into here, and this will be the last kind of work I do with you, is this sound figure of, that involves the spirit, Ruh, in the Qur'an. You see here a rendering of Surah Al-Qadr. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, inna anzalnahu fi laylat al-Qadr, wa ma adraka ma laylat al-Qadr. Laylat al-Qadr khayrun min alf shahr, tanazzalu al-mala'ikatu wa ar-ruhu fiha bi'idhni rabbihim kull yawm. Salamun hiya hatta matla' al-Qadr. We're going to come back and we're going to work with this a little more. Ruh is often a, the ruh in the sense of spirit. And ruh has the same sort of meaning as in Hebrew, ruh. The idea of a wind, of something that carries and brings with it. It's a breeze, it's a wind. And it's in the Quran, often associated with what Michael Sells, who I'm drawing from here, calls boundary moments. Linked to events in which the divine comes into proximity with the human, thus causing suspension of the structures and tempo of daily life. So in Surah Al-Qadr, I'll come back to this maybe. I've sort of already recited it through with you, but maybe I'll come back to this. In Surah Al-Qadr, we encounter Ruh in multiple different phrasings. And when somebody hears, for instance, وَتَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ فِيهَا. That رُوحُ فِيهَا is heard elsewhere. So when you hear that, you also bring to mind other places in the Quran where that phrasing occurs. Now, those of you who know the Quran really well maybe can attest to that. I don't know. When Surah Al-Qadr is recited, and you come to that really important passage in the middle, right, where the angels come down, and the spirit is in her, or on, or in it, or the hadir is not clear. It's ambiguous, and scholars have debated what it refers to. That ruh fiha, the spirit in it, or in her, occurs elsewhere. And in a sense, when you hear that, you also hear, and the image is associated with those other passages comes to mind. So. It occurs in multiple places in the Quran, which human and divine come into close proximity. And particularly with the themes of prophecy, creation, and the final judgment. The phrase thus echoes across the Quran, creating a polyphonic figure. The polyphony generates a multiplicity of associations and meanings for the listener who is well versed in the Quran. It's sort of like being well-versed in American pop culture. You hear Start Me Up and you think of, oh, I've heard that before, over by Microsoft over here. And you sort of connect those things together, right? Same thing with a text like the Quran, Ruh al-Fiyah, oh yeah, I've heard that over here, right? And these two associations then merge into a very complex whole in terms of, and the meaning of that phrase then becomes deeper and richer as a consequence. So here's some passages in which we have that phrase appearing. So, تَنَزَّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَالْرُوحُ فِيهَا. There descend the angels and the spirit upon it, or the spirit upon her. Elsewhere, the Holy Spirit, or Holy Inspiration, نَزَّلُ الْرُوحُ الْقُدُسُ مِنْ رَبِّكَ. is said to come down upon Muhammad. Passages concerning the Day of Reckoning include this: Ta'arujul Malaikatul wa Ruhul Ilayhi. There rise the angels and the spirit it upon him to the Day of Judgment. So suddenly, the descent of the spirit on the day in which the Qur'an is revealed to Muhammad, right? This is what this refers to. There descend the angels and the spirit upon her. In this passage of the surah of the Qur'an, Surah Al-Qadr, the Surah Al-Qadr, that I recited earlier to you, is all about the descent of the Qur'an to the Prophet Muhammad. So it's traditionally understood. But that very descent of the spirit associated with the descent of the revelation of the Prophet Muhammad is also associated with the Day of Reckoning. The spirit will rise up on the Day of Reckoning, animating that day. The very same spirit. We also find it in passages concerning Mary. نَفَخْنَا فِيهَا مِنْ رُحِنَا. We breathe into her our spirit, and as a result, she becomes impregnated in the absence of a man and gives birth to Jesus, who is a spirit from God. فَأَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْهِ رُحَنَا فَتَمَثَّلَ لَهَا بَشَرًا زُوِيًا. And we sent to her our spirit, which appeared before her as a human shape. Elsewhere, Jesus is described as God's spirit, وَرُحَنْ مِنْهُ. So we have the spirit descending on the night of power, the night in which the revelation is given to the prophet. We have the spirit rising up on the final day, animating that day. We have the spirit being breathed into Mary, and as a consequence, she becomes impregnated in the absence of a man with Jesus. And we find the spirit as well in accounts of Adam's creation, the very first human being. And when I formed him and breathed into him of my spirit, the hymn refers to here the basharan min teen, the human form made of mud, that is Adam. But that human form only becomes animated when what? When the spirit is breathed into him, much in the way that the spirit was breathed into Mary. Let's think about all of this a little bit more. Again, he formed him and breathed into him of his spirit. If you think about this a little bit, you begin to understand how what emerges here is a very complex figure that is rendered sonically through the repetition of these phrases. When you hear them, you are, in a sense, experiencing a multi-layered sonic phenomenon that brings together all of these associations into a single meaning. Or multi-layered meaning. I want to talk about in terms of a gynocentric sound figure that brings together creation, prophecy, and the final day. Here on the screen you see a depiction of Mary sitting beneath the palm tree with the baby Jesus. The Ruhu Fiha is a gynocentric metaphor, I want to argue, of prophecy and divine creative and destructive action. The Nazalu Malaik Du Wa Ruhu Fiha, the night here, the night in which the spirit is said to descend, on the night in which the prophecy is given to the prophet, is associated with the descent of the spirit into the night, as if the night, and the night here is referred to, I would argue, through the pronoun ha, a feminine pronoun. The night is partially personified as a woman. The giving of prophecy then is associated obliquely with coming of the spirit to a woman. Nafakhna fiha min ruhina. The object here, in this case, referring to Mary. This is taken from the passages concerning Mary. We breathe our spirit into her. Here we have another example of the spirit coming to a woman and giving birth to, if you will, a prophet. Not a prophecy, but one who will give a prophecy. This gender figure emerges through the polyvocality of the ruha fiha phrase, the ways in which it occurs in these different contexts. The ha pronominal ending in fiha is gender ambiguous. Either he or it, or even them. The spirit descends upon her and it, whether her and it refers variously to the night on which the prophecy is given to Muhammad, which becomes, if you will, impregnated with the prophecy. It gives birth to the prophecy, if you will. Maryam becomes impregnated with Jesus through the action of the Spirit. Adam comes to life when the Spirit is blown into him. The Spirit brings life, brings knowledge, and brings judgment. So, summing up here, when listeners hear the word Aurora, an entire host of images and feelings converge. The prophet's shattering experience of prophecy, Mary's experience, equally shattering, of giving birth to Jesus, the creation of the first human, the day of reckoning. All of these things are multi-layered for the listener as he or she encounters these renderings. Okay. I'm not going to go through all of this. I'll just leave them on the screen. I've used up quite a bit of time, and I meant to leave some time for questions, but we have about 5 minutes. I'll be happy to take any questions you have.
How does the sound figure survive a translation?
It doesn't. And can't. And that's the problem with translation, right? I think Muslims rightly argue that there is no Quran other than in its Arabic form. And when translated, it is a version of the Quran or an interpretation of the Quran. But doesn't that make sense? I mean, that a piece of poetry, I mean, I'm not saying the Quran is poetry, but let's take poetry as an example of something that is notoriously hard to translate. That, in a sense, poetry, if it's to be fully understood, has to be heard. And perhaps memorized and internalized, right? As a musician, I understand that it's not good enough simply to play the notes on the page, but I have to memorize those notes, and I have to internalize them, make them my own, and then I have to play them, which is different from, not just play the notes, I have to play music. And playing music is different from playing the notes. And the same, I think the same idea is involved here with how Muslims approach the learning of the Quran. Emphasis is placed on memorization from the very beginning. Learn the Quran, memorize it, make it your own, and understanding will come eventually.